a man who needs not much introduction to you guys, I'm sure. Over 800,000 subscribers on YouTube. Musical polymath. Very interesting chap. I feel very privileged to be able to sit down and have a chat with him this afternoon about music. So without further ado, if you could give it up, please, for Mr. Adam Neely.
Yes, I did request that music. How's it going, everybody? My name is Adam, and I am a YouTuber. I am a musician, polymath. I like that word. That's a good word.
Hi, Adam. Thanks for coming in to talk to us. You use memes and meme culture in your videos a lot, which is something that I really enjoy. Even if it's not directly with like the V-Source references and the lick and stuff, it's like the way that you use post-internet language. And there are some bands like Wolfpack come to mind, bands that are using this to kind of promote their own music.
Mm-hmm.
And we've just seen Old Town Road absolutely blow up because of TikTok.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to know, what are your thoughts on the future of, do you think people are going to start like engineering music to incorporate meme culture from the off in terms of how it's written? Do you think that will be well received?
Or I mean, I think it's already happened. I mean, okay, so a meme, all a meme is like an idea. It's like a joke that's shared from one person to the next and one person to the next. That's at the core of what music is. Most of the time, it's not funny, but sometimes. Okay, this is my thought on this. Does anybody know the French folk song "L'Homme Armé"? Probably not. But does anybody know it? Okay, it was the big hit meme of the 14th century. Everybody wrote some kind of joke song based on "L'Homme Armé." You had something called parody masses, which was this. This was a little bit before Palestrina, but you had all of these composers of the time were basically sneaking in "L'Homme Armé" into these very serious masses that the church, like they didn't realize that it was happening, but it was basically like the lick of the 14th century. So "L'Homme Armé" was everywhere. It was like kind of the big joke. Everybody was like laughing for like 50 years about "L'Homme Armé." And because of that, it then spurred a very interesting, intricate style of composing in the Renaissance, and it was very important, really, for the development of Western music, was the meme of "L'Homme Armé," and that's kind of Bach in the Brandenburg Variations, the final Brandenburg Variation. He quotes like all these drinking songs, Mozart would like throw in all this like really jokey trash humor, like scatological humor, and a lot of this stuff. There's this joking culture in like all of music. It's always been that way. Seeing it like Wolfpack or seeing it like my dumb channel or whatever, like that's just a part of what being a musician is you joke around a lot. Treating music super seriously as if you can't reference anything is, I think, the death. It's not fun, one, and it's just not how it's ever been done. It's if you treat it so seriously that you can't find a little bit of humor or self-reference or anything. There's the Dies Irae, which is da 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 da.
In your Dark Horse video, right?
What?
The Katy Perry Dark Horse video you did. You talked about that, right?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah. So the Dies Irae, I mean, that's a meme that's like been all throughout the centuries. So self-reference is a big part of music. It's just that now with the internet and like meme culture, that's just like young culture, that's just like hip culture. It's just like now we have pictures to go along with it. That's really all it is. So it's just part of it. The more you joke, the more you throw in self-reference, the more you throw in the lick to everything, although with, taste, that's impossible.
Samples are certainly memes as well, right?
Sorry?
Samples are certainly
For sure,
great example of that, right?
Oh my God, yeah. Sample, I mean, that's a great point. Like, I feel like the invention of the sampler was like, all right, we're gonna get really memey with this music right now. Throwing in samples, like mashups, oh my God.
Do you remember the sweep that came in on all the sort of trap and hip-hop stuff like probably about 10 years ago?
Yeah.
And now if you used it, it would be referencing that as a joke rather than
being
using this seriously. So I do think it happens.
That's the fascinating thing, is because music then becomes self-referential, and then yeah. music is imbued with meanings beyond the sounds themselves, which is amazing. So there's this Ella Fitzgerald scat. I forget exactly. She used to reference a tisket, a tasket, a green and yellow basket, and like every single time that she would scat. Now to the point where nobody has ever heard the original song. This is like really sing-songy, like nursery rhyme song. But if you sang it in a middle of a scat, you'd be referencing Ella Fitzgerald, not the original song. So everything is a reference to other things. And the more that you understand these references to other things, which are just memes, just like on a larger scale, like the more understand, like the more textured and more nuanced your like music will become. So I think meme culture is a big and important part of music, but it's like so much larger than just meme culture itself.
Just one more side yeah. question, because I think that was a fascinating question to yeah, open yeah. with there. Do you think there's a danger that we lose sight of the original, you know, when we don't know where our musical memes come from? You know, is there not a danger, but does it make us more dumb? You know, if we kind of, we're not able to trace back the sort of roots of our culture?
And well, nobody knew what L'Homme Armé was.
Right.
It's fine. Like, it becomes awesome when you do trace it cool. back. Yeah. I mean, and then, you know, you trace it back then to the 10th century or whatever. And, you know, that's why we learn history, so we can learn all the jokes. we can learn all those memes and learn all those references. I think I'm not saying it's a bad thing to not know the references, but it becomes cooler to know a lot more right. and learn more of the interconnectedness of everything. Yeah.
Have we got another question? Thank you.
Hiya. Is it true that you're a chromesthete, and how much does that help you play music that's written on your instrument?
All right, so chromesthesia, for those who don't know, is a form of synesthesia, which is a form of pairing senses. I am not a chromesthete. So chromesthesia is basically when you see color when you hear sounds. So for some people, the sound of a violin might literally induce, or like the violin playing C might literally induce what's called a photism, which is the ability to see color around the periphery of your eyes. So when they're listening, a chromesthete is listening to music, there is a constant color happening. And chromesthesia is often associated with perfect pitch. Very often people with perfect pitch have chromesthesia and vice versa. I do not have chromesthesia. I have something called grapheme color synesthesia, which is a much milder form, which is basically I have color associations between letters and, yeah, I have color associations with letters, and because the musical alphabet uses letters, certain notes have color, but it's not based on, like, hearing it. It's based on the idea of color. So the best way of describing this, okay, you see that A on great. We all see it as white, hopefully, and I see it as white. But if A were to have a color, it would have to be red. The same thing with musical A's, if that makes any sense. It's such a minor thing, but it does help me think about, you know, if I'm thinking about the key of A minor, that's such a red key. Like, that is such a red key. Are you talking, like, F is definitely green. And if anybody here has grapheme color synesthesia, you would probably want to fight me on these things. Because the interesting thing is that these color associations are completely random. And they were created, and current research thinks, is that when you're young, when you're looking at the world around you, you're developing this model of the world based upon your senses. So I see this laptop right here. I can touch it. I hear the sound of it. So like there's this model in the world around me of this laptop. And that model, which is created in early childhood, with all these senses happening at the same time, sometimes the senses can get like crossed weirdly. And so then you get synesthesia as a result. And so sometime in my early childhood, I got some weird senses crossed when learning letters and the alphabet and color or something like that. It happens a bunch of times. There's many different kinds of synesthesia, but that's mine. I don't have the chromesthesia, though. That's really fascinating to talk to people with chromesthesia, because their entire perspective of music is really dense. Yeah, it's super cool. If you're interested in synesthesia, check out the music of Alexander Scriabin, who's an early 20th century Russian composer who went really crazy with it. He composed for this musical instrument called La Luce. It's basically a color organ where he, when he would compose big pieces for orchestra, he would write a part for an organ which didn't produce sound but produced different colors, basically like different colored light bulbs. So like, hey, I'm going to play an F right now, and that creates a certain color. And then when the key changes, plays like a, I don't know, a G or whatever. It's a really interesting guy and a really interesting approach to synesthesia.
Sorry, I got the meaning wrong, but I was wondering, because you're a session player as well and you play from manuscript in front of you, how much of an advantage do you think having grapheme color synesthesia gives you compared to other musicians?
Literally none. It's just a cool thing to talk about. It's not an advantage. It's a different way of looking at the world, but it is. I haven't seen any advantage. I haven't been able to take advantage. Maybe I could have thought of one, but I don't think so.
Cool. Any more questions?
I'm still on the color thing, actually.
Oh, yeah.
So what is your favorite color, and do you think that affects your taste in music?
I like blues, various blues. The music and the color. Oh, right. No. I don't think so. No. I'll say this. I really like thinking about color, the relationships between two different colors. And this is something, color theory, which is a thing that artists study, like the relationships, like which colors go well together. If you notice that, like, in many like Hollywood blockbusters, you have color grading of a lot of oranges and blues. And part of the reason for that is they kind of are across from one another in like a color wheel, if you look at a color wheel. And there's this famous quote from Isaac Newton who said that like indigo, blue, and orange go very well together because they are fifths. And there's this idea that the relationship between the frequencies in terms of tetrahertz, like the waveforms of the electron and the electromagnetic spectrum between indigo, blue, and orange, do form about a 3-to-2 relationship, which is kind of similar to the sound of a perfect fifth. This is very metaphorical because light is not the same thing as sound. Light is an electromagnetic radiation or expression of electromagnetic radiation, and sound is a compression wave. But I do like thinking about different colors in terms of their maybe musical relationship to one another. If they're very far apart on the color wheel, chances are they go well together because they form a perfect fifth. If they're very close to one another, within some reason, they almost clash because it's like they're a second. Like, for example, like green and like purple are like very close to one another, and they don't really go that well together if you're trying to create contrast in some kind of image. But that's kind of how I'm thinking about color. Yeah.
Hello. In the past, you've worked with other musicians when it comes to like writing material. Have there ever been kind of like clashes when it comes to your style of like writing or like how you go about songwriting in a way?
Mm. So there's this idea of bands being democracies. I disagree with that. I very much disagree with that. There should always be a band leader. The way that I work, it might work for other people. I like that method as a sideman, as a person who plays their parts, who like follows, because I always will have a means of expressing my thought and my vision for my band. And then I can just play in another person's band also, and then I can just do what they say and follow their lead. I've had the most luck in my professional life if there's always a band leader, somebody who is calling the shots, writing the music, being the top dog, so that I can do my job, I know where I am, I can play my part, fully confident that I also have my own expression when necessary. And so if there's something that I don't necessarily want to do, or like if I disagree with a musical choice in a band that I'm playing in, I'll be like, all right, that's fine. It's not my music, it's their music. I've never been in a situation that's 100% democratic, where everybody comes to a unanimous decision about all songwriting, all that I felt comfortable in. Because power dynamics and power things and then arguments arise, that's not the way that I work. And generally not the way that most of my peers and contemporaries work either. Everybody has their project that they do, and they hire people, and those people play the music and contribute what they can. I found that just works the best for me. Anyway, so down with democracy, I guess.
Great question. I've got one in the front row.
Hey, what's one of the most difficult barriers you've had to overcome in your career, and how did you go about doing that?
Difficult barriers. Well, one of the big things, a lot of what I've done is based out of fear. A lot of what I've done is based out of fear, and I really don't like that. So I come from a musical family, somewhat musical family, like my mom's a musician, my dad isn't. And from an early age, they were like, all right, well, you're going to be poor, so just suck it up if you're going to be a musician. Just marry somebody who has money. That's, you know, do it. Not necessarily the most encouraging words, Ma. Okay, great. But no. So I went into music with a very scrappy attitude of like, all right, I'm going to make money however way I can. I'm not going to worry about like doing my own creative artistic stuff. I'm just going to become a session musician. I'm going to like play with as many people as I possibly can. I'm going to say yes to every gig, because what if I don't say yes to every gig? Like, oh my God, I might be poor. And there's good stuff to be done, like saying yes to every gig. Like, I got a lot of opportunities, but at a certain point, I was just afraid of starting my own musical career, afraid of going hardcore into YouTube. Everything that I was doing was kind of out of fear that I wouldn't be able to make enough money, or wouldn't be able to like look good enough to other musicians, or be able to like, yeah, it was a very fear-based career that I had for the first like 6 or 7 years. So it wasn't until like, it wasn't until I realized I hit a wall, basically. I'm just doing these gigs around town. Like, what's the worst that could happen if I say no? And by learning to say no to something, that was kind of like the turning point for when I actually started like feeling like comfortable in my own skin. And also, coincidentally, when the first time was actually around the Great Algorithm Shift. So the hardest thing was overcoming that, I think. You know, it was pretty poor for a while, pretty scrappy sorts of situations. Yeah, it was romanticizing it, though. I think I romanticized it a lot, which I don't think was very helpful.
Do you fear things, you know, new sort of opportunities much now, or would you
say now I say no. I know myself now.
Right.
I'll say yes or I'll say no.
Yeah.
Depending on what I know about what I can do. Back then it wasn't so much that. Yeah.
Cool.
Do you think that working with other people, is that where you create your inspiration? So like Ben Levin as well?
Yeah. I love shooting videos with other people, because it's YouTube is, and that's part of the reason why I still like play music all the time. It's like YouTube is such a lonely career if that's all you do. You're just talking to a camera, and then you edit yourself, and then it's just staring at you talking for hours on end. And so it's really exciting, like, hang out with fellow YouTubers and just create and just talk and just do stuff together, because we're all on the same wavelength of basically, all right, what can we make? What can we make? All right. It's going to be the top five jelly beans, like jelly bean reharmonization. All right, what can we do with this? Okay. You know, it's that dumb thing. And so eventually we come up to a video idea. It's a very, very creative energy. Every time it's been a very creative energy, which is exciting. Yeah. Any others?
I know you obviously promoted yourself as Adam Neely, the brand TM, and you also work with Sungazer. I don't know if you do any of your own promo for Sungazer?
Yeah, I mean, I do everything for Sungazer.
So how do you feel the main difference is between promoting a band as a brand and promoting yourself as an individual?
That's a great question. Merchandise. You can't put your name on merchandise. You can put a band name on merchandise. yeah, this is a discussion that we have all the time. So Sungazer doesn't really have social media presence. It's me and the drummer Sean Crowder. We just post about our band, but we don't really have social media presence. Like, there's a Facebook page, I guess, but there's not an Instagram or anything, which was calculated. We want to make sure that Sungazer is associated with us, the personal brands. When you're starting out, I think it's a good idea to have both, because a personal brand is, you will never lose that. Like, that is you. Yeah, I don't know. That's a constant like back and forth. But merchandise, honestly, is the big thing that like I've had this discussion with a million people. You can't put your name on merchandise. You can put a band name on merchandise. Super crass way of thinking about it, but hey.
I think we had a question somewhere in the middle of the aisle.
Hi, I really enjoyed your polyrhythmic juggling video you put up recently. And you were saying that music can be a very lonely thing, so that's kind of a way to make it inclusive. Mm-hmm. I was wondering, when do your best ideas come? When you're talking to people or when you're on your own?
I don't know. It depends. Sometimes the best ideas... Okay, so my mom is a music teacher. And she has this whole idea of, it's called lying fallow, which is like, you know, it comes from, I guess, agriculture. Like you let a field lie fallow to like rejuvenate, where you don't do anything. You do absolutely nothing for a long period of time. And then because you have done nothing, your brain has a second to let ideas in. And I do that all the time. Like I never really rack my brain for ideas. I can be talking with people. I get some great ideas talking to people. Sometimes I'm just walking around and just thinking about something, and then that's like the next. I got an idea for a video, like the polyrhythmic juggling video, which is some idea I had on the plane ride to Germany because I didn't really know what I was going to be doing, and I was like, what if we juggle egg shakers? Oh, I wonder if we could juggle polyrhythms and work some stuff out with Paul David's. And we could, and then it was this whole thing. But I think lying fallow is an idea that I think about. It's something that I feel is important. You don't need to be searching for ideas. You just need to, like, chill out for a second. If you find that, like, you go away for, like, 5 days and then come back, it's okay. All of your ideas are still there. You'll still be able to access them. So anywhere. I don't know. That's not the best answer to that, but I think lying fallow is kind of what I think about a lot. So.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah, hey. You know, when you said you were saying yes to everything at the beginning of your career, mm-hmm. and you were acting upon fear, and at one point you decided, like, that's it, I want to change this. So. How do you know how much risk you can take, and like, how do you go about that, let's say?
Well, yeah, I will. Great question. It's something that I'm thinking about a lot. The more into my musical career and my like YouTube career I am, the more risk I can take because I have much more of a foundation. When you're in the beginning, you don't have any kind of foundation, so it's scarier too. But it's also kind of more necessary to take big risks because no guts, no glory. And I definitely wasn't feeling that for the first, you know, part of my career. I can take more risks, therefore I do. This great algorithm shift, which has been up there it's been up there for a second. That was my big break. This was my big break, honestly. I could point to one moment where I said, like, this is when I got on the radio or something like that. This is the thing that like propelled me forward, and then I could like take this opportunity to then like work with it. And then when this happened, I remember the moment that this happened. I was on a wedding gig, and because I was taking a bunch of weddings because I thought weddings were like just the best possible way for me to make my career. And they kind of are, because you meet a lot of great musicians. Weddings are a growth market. People are paying absurd amounts of money now to marry each other, God knows why, but hell, brilliant for musicians. And you know, I was on a wedding gig, and my phone started blowing up because people started commenting a lot on my videos because they started getting promoted. And I was like, oh my God, this is like something that's really exciting and new, and I've been waiting for something like this because I've been doing these weddings for forever. I've been like playing all these crappy gigs and barely scraping by and teaching beginning guitar, like teaching Blackbird for the millionth time to a beginning adult student. Is just kind of soul sucking. But like, I knew a good thing when I saw it, so I kind of went with it. It's hard because I'm not a very risk-taking individual. I'm just not. But because I now have something, a foundation, it's easier for me to take risks than if I don't have a foundation. In the beginning, you're not going to have a foundation, but it's kind of necessary to take risks, and I didn't. So it took me a lot longer to get where I am. Again, I've been making YouTube videos for 13 years. I'm definitely the oldest person, or been doing it for the longest in the game. Like, I've been doing it regularly because I didn't think that it was possible. I didn't like really take the risk to start doing it regularly until recently. So it is a hard balance, but that's kind of like how I've approached it. It's being risk averse is not really the way of doing it, even though it's kind of like how I was in the beginning. Yeah, if this didn't happen, my career would have been very different. I got very lucky. I got very, very lucky.
Hi, Adam.
Yep.
So being that you're a music graduate yourself, what advice would you give in regards to making the best use of your time post-graduation, and when opportunities sort of come your way, what advice would you give just about how to manage that?
Yeah, so everybody tries to do everything at once. And everybody kind of does it. Everybody kind of does it. Meaning, like, everybody half-asses everything, which is okay. I would say try and figure out exactly what you want to do, and that's hard. And the way that you figure out what you want to do is by doing everything. So you're a session musician, or you're creating your own original music. What do I want to do here? Find your tribe. That's a big thing. Find the musicians that you want to play with, because they're the people that you're going to be sharing gigs with. They're going to be the people that are in your original bands. They're going to be people that are playing sessions. Finding your tribe is also a great mental health thing. You got people. People have your back. It is a strange thing in music where your coworkers are your friends. And you're also, the social situations are very different than, I don't know, a 9-to-5 job. But I think finding a tribe is very important, finding the musicians that you're playing with, which your chances are all here right now, because that's usually the reason why you go to music school, is to learn and as well as like meet other musicians. I don't know any individual person, so I can't say what's best for you. But figure out what you need to do. And that might just be doing as much as you possibly can. And eventually it comes back around, and then you know what you need to do.
Yeah. Where do you see your career going in the future? Do you see yourself working more on the YouTube channel or with Sungazer or any other band?
Hopefully more with Sungazer. So next year is definitely going to be the year where we're going to actually be working out a lot more stuff. Still going to be posting on YouTube every week or so, but for the most part, I'm going to try and, you know, make music. That's what I'm here for, you know. That's what we're all here for. We're going to make music, yeah.
So we just got one more at the back there.
How do you know when to say no to something, or an opportunity, or a gig?
Okay. Has anybody heard of the three reasons to take a gig? This is very important. You should... If you don't
make
have
a video, man. Make a video. Next.
Well, it's been mentioned in a video, yeah, okay. but I didn't clickbait it right. The three reasons why you must know, or whatever. I don't care. Okay, yeah, these are the three reasons. So these are the three reasons why you say yes to a gig. You should make sure that there are at least two of them involved. Otherwise, you're going to burn yourself the hell out. The first reason why you should take a gig is if the money is good. Okay, self-explanatory. The second reason why you should take a gig is if the music is good. If there is some kind of musical experience that you can have that is worthwhile to your musicality, your artistry, something that feeds your soul artistically. Those two don't always go hand in hand, but they sometimes do, and that's really nice when they do. And the third reason, and this is, I think, the most important reason, is if the hang is good, if the people are good, if you get along with people on the gig. So, for example, you and your buddies got this gig at this like really crappy dive bar, and the music is kind of terrible that you're supposed to play, but you're with your friends. That only fits like one of those three, and you can't make a career doing that. That's terrible. You don't want to do that. You'll burn yourself out, and you won't make any money. Say that you get this really, really well-paying corporate gig. The music is kind of boring and terrible, and the people are just jaded assholes, and you know, you really hate hanging out with them, but the money is really good. That's a reason to say no, because you've only met one of the three, and you will burn yourself out and will not be sustainable. Say you got you and your friends are playing this like really interesting original indie rock music that you really, really connect with, and it really makes a lot of sense to you, and it really feeds your soul, and you're with great people, and it's a great time, but the money's not all that great. that actually might be sustainable, because eventually the money will come and you will be able to do it night after night after night because the music feeds you and the people feed you. Say you get a gig that is very musically rewarding, that like you're playing with some very, very amazing, like older musicians that like are really, really, the music means a lot to you and the money is incredible, but the hang is a little toxic. That's a harder one to justify, but you can do that for a little bit longer. That's why I think that the hang, the people who are involved in making music, is probably the most important of the three, because if you don't have that hang, then everything else kind of falls apart. So that's one to say no to gigs. Most of the time when I was saying yes to gigs, it was because of the money. And the money was not always that great, but sometimes it was okay. Or it was with, you know, my buddies, but the music was terrible and there was no money involved. So make sure there's at least two of the three, otherwise you won't have a career. In the beginning, you're going to be tempted to say yes for money. Just, you know, make sure there's at least one of the other two involved. Otherwise, it's not going to be, you're going to be an unhappy person. So those are the three reasons. Money, music, hang.
Thanks. Sound advice. So one more question.
Yeah, of course.
Hi. I really love the stuff you do with Sungazer.
Thank you.
And I think it's really creative. And with regards to, like, the creativity, do you think it's something you can learn, or you just have to deal with the cards you've been dealt when you're born? That's creativity you have.
I think of creativity, I mean, this is a cliche, but it's like, it's 1% inspiration, 99% perspiration. It's all work. Everything is always work. And Sungazer is the product of a lot of work. Like, you hear a final product, you hear a song, you hear something, you know, maybe you don't like my music. You're wrong, but... it's totally fine. Nobody needs to like my music, or nobody needs to like your music, but, you know, you want it to be an expression of something that you've worked on. Sean and I have worked on that music for so long. Like, some of the musical ideas that we've been working with, we've just been thinking about shedding, like, it isn't good and it's not good. And you only ever hear, like, the final product. The idea of, like, something spurting from your mind is something that I feel like is kind of a toxic idea. Everything is work. Everything is you making the decision, do I like this? Is this good enough? Yes or no? Next decision. Do I like this? Is it good enough? Yes, no? Next decision. It's a constant decision-making process. Everything from everything. So I don't consider myself a very creative person. I just am pretty good at deciding whether or not I like something or dislike something. And that's, you know, took a lot of practice, because in the beginning you don't really know if you like something or not. Like, is there an objective reason why you might like one rhythm or one sound versus another? In the beginning, you don't know, because you just hear these new sounds, like, I don't know, it sounds whatever. And then eventually you hear it over and over, and then you're like, okay, yeah, maybe I like that one. Maybe I like this one. I think this is a good way of ending it. I love... there's this discussion between Matisse and Picasso. And Picasso felt very envious of Matisse, the painter, because according to Picasso, like, hey, Matisse, yo, whenever you make these pieces of art, it feels like it just like comes directly out. It's just like spurts from the well of creativity. The muses birth this out into the world. But when I make my art, it feels like I'm destroying something. Because I got all these ideas, they're fine. I don't like, but I really have to work. I have to like hack away. Like, I have to hack away at the marble, and eventually I'm just done. And I guess there's art there, but I don't really feel very good about it because it took so long to get there. And for me, art is a sum of destructions. And that's really how I feel about creating art and anything. It's just, I have ideas and then I work at it for a long time, and eventually there's something that comes out of it. YouTube videos, music, whatever. And I've thought about that for a long time. It's just the amount of work that you put into it is what creativity is. It might seem overwhelming in the beginning because you're only seeing the end product, but ask anybody and it starts with a simple idea and then you put in a crap ton of work into it.
Awesome. Well, thank you very much. I think we'd all agree it's been really inspiring, really interesting to hear you speak today. Thanks for coming down and taking the time out to speak to us.
Thanks for having me. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you.
Please give it up for Adam Neely.
Thank you so much.